All right, welcome everybody. It's a great pleasure and honor to be on this panel with my esteemed colleagues. I'm Giuseppe Ugazio, I'm professor in behavioral philanthropy and finance at the University of Geneva. And today I'm going to be moderating this fantastic panel on philanthropy for sustainable development and peace, time for a new paradigm. Without any further ado, I'd like to give the words in turn to the panelists who are going to make a short introduction so we all get to know them, and then we'll dive into the topic. And I'll start with Nina. You're the head of LGT Philanthropy Advisory. Can you tell us more?
Yeah, so thank you, first of all, and lovely to meet you here in the audience. So I'm Swedish by birth, actually, but I lived quite a lot abroad, which I guess shaped a lot of my career path. And I started working for the United Nations, which is the only thing that I knew that I ever wanted to do in terms of growing up. So I worked for the UN for many years. So half of my career I've been spending mainly working in the field, but also at headquarter level. And then in 2010 or so, I started being intrigued by philanthropy and the way that you can accomplish change, but through private means and approaches. So I started working as a philanthropy advisor and was many years with UBS Philanthropy Advisory. And now, since almost 4 years, I came to LGT, which is a family-owned bank, so it's fully owned by the princely family of Liechtenstein, who themselves bring these philanthropic values also through their work in the financial industry. So sustainability impact investing is very important for LGT, as well as philanthropy advisory that I lead since a few years, and brought a small team, all women, working as philanthropy advisor. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Nina. Etienne, since you're already there, I'll move to you. You're a managing partner at Wise, and I guess for all the Genevans, if you say philanthropy, you kind of say Etienne, so we don't need to present, but for, you know, the internationals, can you please also share
a bit of your background? A nice fallacy, but thank you for being here, and thank you for Wallace for the invitations and for the organizations. We're very thrilled for that panel, and I think sitting in Maison de la Paix in those days is a very symbolic act, and congratulations for the event. So my name is Etienne Eichenberger. I'm a very Geneva person since I grew up here and I study here. So I've been working here. So I spent some time abroad as well, almost 10 years. But when I came back 20 years ago, the idea was to help philanthropy to be more professionals. Not that the philanthropy was amateur, but the philanthropy to serve actually for the wealth being created, also a level of professionalism in being spent and given or invested, as we will hear later on the stage. So in that capacity, I started a philanthropy advisory firms called Wise Philanthropy Advisors, and we're like Nina, we do a very similar job, and we tremendously enjoy that. It's a fantastic job to have, because you help people to fulfill a responsibility, a dream, or wishes to accomplish a greater good while living. And I think it's a very exciting job. So I'm thrilled about the panels. That being said, in philanthropy, I am also quite active in Geneva in different sphere, and also chairman of a foundation called Swiss Philanthropy Foundations. I might mention the conversations also in getting youth in philanthropy. So excited about the conversation.
Thank you, Etienne. I'll jump over Rudelmar first to go to let you introduce yourself. So you're Secretary General of ACT Alliance, originally from Brazil, but based now here in Switzerland.
Yes, before coming to Switzerland, I passed by several countries. My education is related to international relations and also export-import. I work in the private sector, but back in Brazil, I joined the philanthropic work. I work for a foundation that was providing support in agriculture, education, and many other places in the country. Then I joined an international organization based in Geneva, a global humanitarian organization, and I work in several countries, visit about 100 plus countries related to the humanitarian work. I also work in New York as the representative of the World Council of Churches to the UN. And more recently, 7 years ago, I was elected the General Secretary of the ACT Alliance. That is a global coalition of humanitarian development and advocacy organizations, faith-based Christian organizations, that are operating in 125 countries, and a membership of international, national, and local organizations. That's basically myself.
Thank you so much, Rudelmar. Elena, we go from Etienne being a local Genevois to a local Zurichois. Do you want to introduce, also say a bit more about yourself? You're head of communication and partnerships at Elea, and if you can tell us a bit more.
Yes, thank you, Giuseppe, for the introduction. Very nice to meet you. I'm Elena. I work for Elea Foundations for Ethics in Globalization. We are a Zurich-based philanthropic impact investor. Before joining Elea, I worked with UBS in sports sponsorship and for the art collection. I then decided that I want to invest my professional energy more for doing good, for those that actually really need more of our support, and I changed into philanthropy. I worked for a corporate foundation in the healthcare environment, and I was at the helm of it for 8 years before I then, in 2021, joined Elea to build up the newly to be developed team of communications and partnerships. Elea, as I briefly said, is a philanthropic impact investor. Our aim is to fight absolute poverty, so address the needs of the people that live with less than $3.60 per day, the World Bank definition of absolute poverty. We invest in early stage impact enterprises in the Global South, along four investment teams, which I will share later more about. We have been, after initial grant by the founding family, we now have a circle of 50 philanthropic investors supporting us. That's entrepreneurially minded families, high net worth individuals, other foundations, family offices, but also organizations that share our belief in entrepreneurial philanthropy.
Thank you, Elena. I'll now go to Shachi. You're a founder of the MaolKeki Foundation and the director of AgriMayum. And please do tell us more about yourself.
Thank you, Giuseppe. Good morning, everyone. So my name is Shachi Gurumayum. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Wallace, for the invitation and all the coordination. So I am originally from a state called Manipur in India. This is a state that is in India's northeast region, which is currently trapped between the turmoil in Myanmar and also what you've been hearing and reading about what's going on in Bangladesh. It is a very small state, you know, half the size of Switzerland with a third of the population, 3 million people roughly. And I consider myself as one of the fortunate ones to come out of the state on a scholarship, go to one of India's top schools, and then, you know, further studies in England, France, the US. Finally, ended up working for a very large agri-tech company in Basel. I did that for 10 years or so, but then I had this nagging thought about, you know, what can I take back to my people? I grew up in an agricultural community, and having learned so much about agriculture, I've worked in Africa for now 16 years because part of my responsibility was the Africa business. And I spent 3 years in Nigeria as a country director there. So all of those learnings, how do I take them back? And that's essentially when I started the MaolKeki Foundation along with my my parents. Because it's such a remote area and a very small state, you don't get a lot of exposure and interest from donors and you know development organizations around the world, unless maybe when there is a crisis, which is what's happening right now. And so unless we ourselves, people who have achieved at least something, can take it back to the state and help, you know, develop the state, nobody else is going to start it. And that's essentially how we ended up starting the MaolKeki Foundation. I can tell you more about it, but I also set up a company in Baselland, in Munchenstein, as an entrepreneur supporting ag tech companies, very sort of nature-based. And I'm a formulation chemist by training, which is why, you know, one of the things I did was to come up with this physiotherapy massage cream, Balmetica it's called, because it's short for Balm and Helvetica. I have samples if later you're interested. But I'm trying to combine, you know, entrepreneurship and what I learned from working in my professional life with philanthropy, with the development sector, working with smallholder farmers back in Manipur and helping them achieve economic progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Shachi. And Luyu, you're a co-founder of Hand in Hand Foundation, a foundation based in China. Do you also want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, thank you. I'm Luya Wu and I come from Beijing, China. I've been working for a philanthropy institution for like 10 years, and we basically focus on children's welfare, especially their health care, both physically and mentally. We believe that it is very important for take care of these children, especially abandoned children who, like many of them, suffer from severe health issue, and we raise funds for them and we bring people to there to take care of them and give them a company. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the introduction. As you could hear, we have a super rich panel that ranges from people who have more experience with a broader perspective on philanthropy to those who actually have their own organizations and do more specific work. So I really can't wait, and I'm super excited to now get a bit more into the depth. The topic of the conference, of course, is ethics, and philanthropy and ethics is one of the recurrent themes that you will hear during this this panel. But first of all, I will start with Nina, and I will pick on your over 15 years experience. And you know, you've probably seen more philanthropy than most in the room. And did you pick any trends that were recurring in the past years that, you know, you see over and over repeating themselves, maybe across the different areas of the world, and especially given the conference on ethics, if there is some particular ethical nuance that you've observed that you want to share with us?
Yeah, sure. I don't think I have more experience on philanthropy than the people in this room, but I did start with philanthropy in 2010. And I think the scene or the sector back then is probably very different from what it looks like now. And there are a few trends for sure that I've seen throughout this decade or so. And I would say some common themes that I, you know, I've been working with philanthropy advisors along, so like colleagues like Etienne and so. And I think a few things back in 2010, we didn't hear anything about impact investing, for instance. This was really just then starting, or philanthropy advisory as a profession wasn't necessarily known either, right? But there are quite a few positive trends. And I would say one, obviously, philanthropy is growing. That I think we see a steady but surely trend in philanthropy growing. There was a quick uptake, I would say, in 2020 during the pandemic. We saw a very steep uptake, but we didn't necessarily see that on a continuous trajectory. But it is definitely growing. So philanthropy is growing. And I think one of the bigger and most important trend there is that we see interactions between philanthropists, foundations, organizations. So the collaborative philanthropy is a very, very positive and very welcome trend. And I would dare saying back in 2010 as well, when we started working in this field, collaboration or partnership was definitely something sought after. But today we are almost, this is almost something that you need to do in order to have more impact. So we start seeing collaborative philanthropy, we start seeing collaborative funds, and you see that you're quite involved in quite a few of them, but things like co-impact, for instance. So big donors giving big money to big funds for systems change, and systems change actually as a phenomenon and an approach is, I would say, probably the most significant trend that we see. So today, rather than fighting causes and the charity work here and there, what we start seeing is more strategic philanthropy. Strategic philanthropy in the sense that you have an issue and you almost want to disrupt the whole system in which that issue is actually embedded. And so systems change in hand with collaborative philanthropy really makes philanthropic capital much more effective. I would say. Another trend would be maybe the blurring lines. I mentioned impact investing was not necessarily on the topics or on the words, definitely not at UBS where I was working back at the time, but it was something that they started to think about and started to be in the media. And nowadays, though, we start seeing these blurring lines almost between philanthropic capital, social investments, impact investing, venture philanthropy. So it's more about finding a cause that you want to address, and then you find the sort of approach which is the right one for that lever of change. And that could be, you know, investing in social entrepreneurship, or it could be investments, it could be debt financing, it could be impact bonds we hear about nowadays. So all these blurring lines and different approaches in philanthropy has definitely come forward. You were saying how you're adopting your sort of business acumen into your philanthropy. This is something that we start seeing a lot in today. Other than that, I mentioned climate, actually. Climate was not on our agenda back in 2010, not so much. It's definitely something that philanthropists are you know, biodiversity, climate, definitely. Clients that we work with that are active in climate space also put a climate, let's say, lens into their investing. This could also go to gender. We see more of gender and also racial as topics. We see much more community-based philanthropy. So philanthropists being aware also of these power dynamics between the giver and the receiver, if you wish. So getting those communities and hearing from communities and really going on the ground, what is it that is needed, and knowing the paradigm and the power shifts and the power dynamics, let's say. Yeah, maybe that is a little bit of a whirlwind. I leave it to that. But I guess also working in the philanthropy advisory space, you know, being or seeing systems change as the sought after approach nowadays, we do see more and more demand for advisory or philanthropy advisory. That is one thing. And I think our role to promote more and better philanthropy is definitely something that we keep in mind when we're working, right? But also that role of working with a lot of philanthropists and being able to connect philanthropists with one another to facilitate the collaboration between philanthropists. I think that is, at least what I'm seeing in philanthropy advisory, one of the biggest maybe value proposition that we have, just that way of being able to connect in order to maximize impact by pooling philanthropists and connecting them together. I'll stop there.
Thanks, Nina, for this excellent overview of the trends that we've been seeing in the past. Maybe to take a step back, right? You mentioned people already investing their wealth and so on in philanthropic projects or even in impact investing, so that it's not only seeking profit, but also to make some purpose. Etienne, do you think that wealth owners actually have a moral obligation, if you wish, to, you know, devote part of these capitals to philanthropy?
Thank you, Gazio. We're fully in the topic of the ethical debate. I'm happy to answer to that, but I'd like to make an introductory statement. I think as advisor, we learn to be very humble, because as I often said, our expertise is to be the other people's generosity, not our own. So we have to be very humble, because when we advise people, we have to have both experience and integrity, and always be aware we're not talking about spending our own wealth. We're advising people that wants to engage. And wealth as such is not only money, but also networks, skills, as we just heard on stage. But let me then answer to your questions, but just as a, not as a disclaimers, but that's a posture that actually you have to be very humble. But since the topic is on ethics, I was reflecting on the statement. Let me come up with three main elements you touch a little bit upon. I think as citizen of the world, there are three things as an introduction comments we probably need to focus on whenever we are able. I think the first one is to vote. We expect it in democracy to speak up our mind. I think it's an important thing to do as individuals. And then I go to the wealth owners. But I think before to be a wealth owner, you're a citizen. then I think you have to pay taxes, because actually states are, in many countries, the best way to operate common goods in many ways, and even charity and NGO are trying to define, help, or challenge the states. You have to pay taxes. And thirdly, I think you have to find some level of engagement. And philanthropy can be one of them. That's my point about wealth owners. But I don't think it's an obligation. I think at best it's a responsibility. And I think us within the sector, we carry that responsibility to make philanthropy, you know, both attractive and efficient, producing results, impact that we can lead. And I'm not saying it's something you sell, but you have to find a way to engage people. That's our responsibility. You cannot claim people don't give if you're not able to provide results, if you're not responsive to demand. So there is some level of mutual engagement. But that was for my introductions. For my 3 points on your on the responsibility. The first one, I think philanthropy, and I try to speak of my 20 years of advising. The first one, I think philanthropy should be faster. I think too often we promise eternity to people that create foundations. Too often we claim that managing the asset of small foundations will last forever. And I think too often foundations are very lengthy in taking decisions. I think philanthropy, both foundations as existing foundations and known foundations as philanthropists, we should learn to be faster. Crises are coming one after the others. You cannot help them all. You have to know when you don't say no, choosing. Giving is choosing, and choosing is saying no, but you have to be faster in your decision-making process. I chair foundations where we've received 400 million. It's a community foundation in Geneva, and 3 out of the 4 francs we receive have already spent out. There is no meanings to be hosting funds unless that's the wish of the donors. But so that's my first point, is about being faster. My second one, join your point, I think sometimes philanthropy, and I'm not judgmental, I'm trying from my experience. I think sometimes philanthropy could be smarter. It's not about responding a lot of demand and, you know, out of 120 you receive, choosing 90 because it's kind of tough to say no. I think you have to know what you want to give. And the trends we see is people being more proactive, people taking more times about being decisive of what they want to do. And that's what I mean by being smarter, is know what you want to do. But I think by being smarter is also about on the responsibility, and I know you all heard Melissa Parks before of ICANN. Our foundations is having a circle of donors that support the work of ICANN. And I think when you have made your wealth in the upside of technology, you have to reflect also on the downside of technology. And I think ICANN is really one of the way forwards as a system change initiative that is, I observe, which has huge challenge to be funded. But frankly, this is probably one of the way forwards to get our world somehow stable on that specific issue. So I think philanthropy and embedded collaboration, as you stated. So my second point is about being smarter. By being smarter, it gets not judgmental, but when you have been successful in life, when you have achieved as wealth owner something, you should put the same level of expectation, professionalism, as when you give money. That's my second. And I observe that, and certainly you do, and certainly you are an expression. So, but I think we should even need more of that. And my last one is really the questions about more. Again, I think the question is not a moral one. I have the chance, like others, to work with people who are very generous. But I think when we look at society, this is a real question, you know, in face of inequality. How much do I have to spend out while living? And I think too often I find people are trapped in situations in our societies where giving is about what people think of you. I think this is not about what people think of you, of what you should do. I think philanthropy is about who you are. And I'm sorry to have to quote Winston Churchill, which some time back, but he said, we make a living about what you get, and you make a life about what you give. I think it's important. And don't wait the end of your life. And I see that this is, and we have again testimonial on stage, but I see, and that's what we do as advisors, work with people while living, want to do the right things, make the critical choice that are needed for society. And I observe that with a lot of humility. And that's why I started with that statement. I think those are values. The challenges are huge. Philanthropy will only be a very small piece, but sometimes it can be a decisive piece. So in that sense, I think it's not so much the obligations as the responsibility, because your wealth is made of talent, ties, and obviously treasure, but not only.
Thank you, Etienne, for this perspective. And so Elena, we've heard blurring lines. We heard the term impact investing. We heard the term climate. All these terms, basically, you can directly associate with Elea Foundation. And also this new paradigm, right, of doing things more collaboratively and potentially in a smarter way. And at Elea, you're championing entrepreneurship philanthropy or philanthropreneurship. Can you tell us more about this approach and why do you pursue it? What's particularly interesting of this approach?
As I briefly mentioned in my short introduction, our focus is poverty alleviation, and we do that through entrepreneurial means. So what does that mean, and how do we do it? We invest in early stage impact enterprises in areas of the world where people live in absolute poverty. So that's in sub-Saharan Africa, across Latin America, and in Asia. We have four dedicated investment themes: agricultural value chains, last mile retail and services, employable skills, and climate and livelihoods. We have identified those four themes because that's where we believe we can really make an impact for and serve the people living in absolute poverty. We spend a lot of efforts in identifying these impact ventures. So per year, our team screens between 800 and 1,000 entrepreneurial ideas. We then have a very rigorous pipeline process where we do around 50 preliminary investment recommendations and 20 due diligences to, in the end, invest in 5 to 7 ventures a year. So you see it's a very, very time-consuming process. So, and when we invest, we mainly invest through equity. We also do some convertible and very little grants. We are a very active investor. So what does that mean? We sit in the boards of most of the impact ventures we invest in. We are very hands-on. We have close collaboration with the founder and his team, and we have very active conversations with them. We help them in finding, for example, other co-investors. We support them in strategic decisions, etc., etc. So we're very hands-on and very engaged. And while almost all of our ventures pursue a path to profitability as a condition for them to be a sustainable impact venture, Elea is, as I briefly mentioned, a tax-exempt foundation, according to the Swiss law. So what does that mean? That means that when we invest, of course, with the ambition to, at some point, be able to exit. But when we make a profitable exit, but this profit does not go back to our investor, so our founder, but also the 50 philanthropic investors we have, but is fully reinvested. So it's like a circle of capital, but nobody gets the principal back. That's why we are philanthropic, and that's also why investments in Elea are considered tax exempt foundations in Switzerland. So why do we believe this approach is powerful? Why entrepreneurial philanthropy? At Elea, we are convinced that entrepreneurship is the most effective catalyst, really, for change and progress. And that investing in innovative entrepreneurial solutions is one of the most promising answers to some of today's most pressing problems that we face. Because impact-oriented enterprises, they offer people access to jobs, they offer access to markets, to value chains. And in doing so, they give people the prospect for a self-determined life. And in the end, also by doing so, they promote really the resilience of societies as a whole.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Elena, for sharing this innovative perspective, speaking of time for new paradigms. And Shachi, you basically embody a philanthropreneur, since you're both a philanthropist and entrepreneur. Tell us more about, you know, the concrete approach that you have with your foundations, and maybe some of the various projects that you have. What makes them special? What makes your foundation's approach special?
Thank you, Giuseppe. So, philanthropreneur. So like I said, you know, Manipur is very remote. And when we talk about philanthropy bringing sustainable development and peace, we are talking about a population of 3 million people with its unique 2,000-year-old history, civilization, you know, because it has a language, a script, 29 different tribes with 29 different dialects. So in some ways, one tribe could not communicate with the other because they don't speak the same dialect. This is how complex the region is. And this morning we heard about, you know, a polarized world and how do we bring peace and so on. I think the what I saw is a general lack of empathy, understanding, trying to understand each other, empathize with one another's, you know, maybe historical rationales, origins, and try to build a common society together. Now, when you look at Manipur with all of these different ethnic groups, it's almost impossible to just put two people together from two different backgrounds and say, you make peace and work together. It doesn't work like that. So what I saw as an opportunity was, you know, Imphal is the capital. You drive 10 minutes and you're already in the paddy fields of Manipur. Smallholder farmers, 70 to 80% of our rural population is dependent on agriculture. So we started with the first thing that could make the most impact, which is work with farmers. And when you're talking about agriculture, everybody needs to eat. They need food security. And so whether you are, you know, ethnic group A or ethnic group B, you have a common purpose. Now, on that purpose, you can work together and build that empathy, that relationship and understanding of each other's challenges, and you build a peaceful society. Now, we obviously haven't done a lot of it, which is why we still have conflicts. But that helped to also engage with the rural youth, because there's a huge percentage of rural youth who are unemployed looking for opportunities. But as we spend more time, we realize that farmers don't want to stay as farmers. You know, it's the same, whether you're in Africa, you're in Europe, or Asia, a smallholder farmer doesn't want to stay as a smallholder farmer forever. And so we saw this opportunity to develop agri-entrepreneurs, because some of them came up to us and said, we want to add value. What can we do more than just primary agriculture? We're tired of it. And so we started adding entrepreneurial training as part of our program in partnership. Again, partnership is so important. We could not scale our activities if not for the partners that we have. Now, on the back of this, we started building the Agri-Entrepreneur Program, which then immediately leads to, yes, you've got value addition ideas, you've got a great concept, but how do you prove that concept and how do you scale it? Then comes in the requirement for financing. Now, we as a foundation can finance only so much. We are a very small philanthropic organization, but what I've learned is through partnerships, through in-kind contributions, donors and others, we've been able to multiply, every $10 that we put in to 7 or 10x. And this, if you think in terms of Silicon Valley terminologies, this is a huge growth. You know, 10x growth for a foundation in terms of fundraise, okay, at a very small level, so please. but it makes a meaningful impact, and that is what we're looking for. And so one of the other things in most rural parts of the world is lack of access to healthcare. You will find that in Africa, in rural parts of Asia, you have primary healthcare facilities that are dysfunctional, or there is a lack of staff or skilled staff. And so what we decided to do was as we were organizing farmer training days, demo farmers or demonstration farmers who are practicing good agricultural practices that we teach on their own farms and then using that as a demo farm to teach their community of farmers, we would organize demo days and invite them, you know, the farmers in the community to come and learn. But on those days, we would also bring along a doctor, a nurse, you know, an ophthalmologist, because many of them suffer from eye issues, working directly in direct sunlight, but also in paddy fields with water reflecting sunlight into your eyes, even if you wear a hat. These are issues that we never saw until we started working with them and integrated healthcare as part of our last mile agricultural outreach. That is the one thing that we do differently. I learned this lesson actually in Nigeria, because in Northern Nigeria, as part of Syngenta, the company that I was working for at the time, we went to train smallholder farmers in the state of Kano, for those of you who know Nigeria. And so as we were in this village talking to the farmers, they said, oh, you know, and in 2 days' time, we will have another group coming. And I said, that's interesting. What are they doing? Oh, they're going to come and tell us about healthcare. I thought, that's interesting. You know, healthcare, agriculture, there is no conflict of interest if you think about it. But the logistical challenge of getting to that village, of getting the people coordinated and organized, and then also the time. You know, you're asking the same group of individuals. We call them farmers. Pharmaceutical companies call them patients. Same people, same group of people. So we said, okay, why not combine the two and do what we have to do in one day, provide them, lunch or tea break, but try and combine it and leverage each other's resources. So you multiply your impact. That's kind of what we've been experimenting and doing quite well. So just to wrap up with some examples, we've trained about 6,000 smallholder farmers in the state of Manipur, provided healthcare assessment, primary health assessment. So you identify the symptoms early on, get treatment if need be before they have to go to tertiary care and spend all that money. We've reached just over 3,000 because of COVID and the ongoing crisis that started in May last year. We haven't been able to put people together. So this has been a barrier in terms of organizing large groups of people. But that's essentially what we've done. With the crisis, with the internally displaced, we have 70,000 at the beginning, 70,000 estimated internally displaced persons within a population of 3 million. That's a significant percentage. And many of them ran with nothing else but the clothes that they were wearing. Okay. And of course, when you think about rural communities, most of the relief camps were in rural communities where already healthcare access was a challenge, especially female health hygiene. So one of the things that we learned very quickly was many of the people who ran, most of them were women and children to fight. And so many of these internally displaced persons were women and adolescent girls who had, of course, their natural cycles. But then without access to proper facilities, without sanitary pads. So we ended up distributing sanitary pads to over 10,000 IDPs in the immediate aftermath of this before other people could step in. We talked about livelihoods. So as internally displaced persons, you cannot expect them to just stay forever in a relief camp. So we've also been transferring some of the agri-entrepreneurial learnings that we had to train IDPs to become financially independent. So whatever skills they had from before, we try to multiply that, train them on making, you know, dolls, making candles, tailoring, and all sorts of things that could earn them, you know, even if it's only $3 a day, it is still an income that they can spend on buying notebooks for their children, clothes for their children to go to school, this sort of things. I will stop at that.
Thank you, Shachi. Thank you. And speaking of innovation, maybe Luyu, if you want to also share with us your experience with your foundation, we heard some of the innovations that in India. Can you tell us more about the innovation you're promoting with the Hand in Hand Foundation in China?
Thank you. I think one of the biggest innovations we made is that we encourage children to help their peers. And we respond to promote this within school, and we try to make them engage in our activities and, you know, activities like toy sales and our stuff sales. And we're trying to uncover the stories of children in need, and we raise the awareness of these children who experience severe health issue or who are abandoned, and in many cases, both. 80% of our fund came from children themselves. And we believe that it benefits both the children who, you know, trying to help other children and these who receive the help. Because for these children who engage in our activities, they have a chance to have a palpable life experience with like children from other class. And this experience is really valuable, especially in these days where the class segregation becomes more and more severe. It is important for us to see different people with our own hands, with our own eyes, so that it helps us to reduce misunderstanding. It helps us to see the similarity between people instead of just the differences. Because, well, we often value, like we exaggerate the differences between different groups because that's how we define others. And the only way to reduce the these differences, this division, is to have the real life experience that we share with other groups. So we know what they really need instead of trying to fulfill their imaginary needs. Like, based on my experience, I haven't seen a single children who really love children's song. And the only way we know it is that we really spend time with them, so we know what they want. And I believe that another innovation we made is that our institution is based on internet. We have a close collaboration with Qingsong Health, which is an like internet-based company. And we connect with others, hospital and doctors on the internet. We ask them to tell us what children their hospital want and like what their specific wishes is. And we help to fulfill their wishes on the internet as well. We spread this information on the internet and we raise funds from like many people all over China. This way is not over, not only more efficient, but it helps us to put an, like philanthropy in our daily life. So like many activities could happen simultaneously on the internet, and we can get more people involved in charity. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing these fascinating innovations. And Rudelmar, so now to you. In philanthropy, and we've heard many different approaches, more collaboration needed. And to facilitate this collaboration, this approach, even to when you move fast, sometimes it could be really hard that you find yourself quickly at crossroads. How do you sort of can build a concrete ethical code, if you want to call it, that can guide your decision? Can you share some of the, in your experiences, decisions that have been, you know, made well thanks to the ethical decision making that was embedded in them?
Yeah, of course. But, you know, ethical decisions will be part of our daily life. It is actually. And you need to be aware of that. And in the philanthropic work, the development humanitarian, all the time you will be faced by some ethical decisions that you need, and that will have an impact on the population, on the people that will be affected by this decision. That's for sure. So we need to be aware that we need to connect our ethical framework to the mission and objective of our own organization. So that's fundamental. Having said that, of course, I have 30 years of experiences working in humanitarian development and advocacy. I have many, many cases where ethical decisions, we face with ethical decisions to be made. But I would like to say that the ethics they are very much defined by the social and cultural norms that we exist, that exist, and also to the context where we live. So it's not monolithic, it's not only one. There is variations of that, but also the evolving of the world, the politics, the relationships also are shaping values and of course then ethics. I have numerous examples to share, but I would like to focus on two types of ethical decision making. One is related to the more technical or related to standards that we defined ourselves in the work that we will do, and the other one related to principles. For instance, when I worked in Central America in the 90s after the Hurricane Mitch that affected the entire region, we were very much providing support to the communities for rehabilitation, reconstruction, and we had a big water and sanitation project. And we have prepared the project to be with a very clear scope, with the number of communities to be attended, and also with the quality that was associated with the standards that we had in our organizations, that was providing a certain number of liters of water per day for each one of them. But then when the project started and folded, we just immediately realized that the needs were greater than expected. And we have not included even communities, hosting communities. We have focused more in refugees, IDPs. So we had with this technical decision, we involved the community, of course, to discuss that, but should we keep our original plans and to have an excellent project successful with high standards, or we will compromise a little bit the standards to ensure that more people could have. Of course, we made the decision to include people, but based on principles of inclusion and equity. So it's important that we know why you are doing this kind of things. Another situation that I have faced is related to conflict situations. We were providing humanitarian support to a country where was facing a civil war. And there was a community that was trapped by the conflict between the army and the guerrilla. And we had to provide support, especially food and medicines, because these communities were at the point of starvation. But the armed groups, they were asking for a bribe, a fee to enter the communities. So we had to make this principled decision, ethical decision. Should we pay the bribe and support somehow the continuation of the conflict and financing armed groups? Or should we go and provide that and save lives? So we made the decision to pay the bribe. And based on the humanitarian principles that was very much associated with our organization at that time. So during the philanthropic world, we always will have this kind of situations. But it's important that we have a robust, as philanthropic organization, ethical framework that can give us these dimensions. And also indicating the implication that could have politically, in terms of reputational things, we need to have to make this decision based on principles and informed principles, and also to assume the responsibility for that. But as it was mentioned by my colleagues, the philanthropic world is and framework is changing very quickly, and also the world. We know that we are facing a very strong polarization, politicization of all the elements of our lives. And that is affecting values very, very badly. And of course, as values are associated with ethics, ethics is being normalized in some situations that are exclusive, not inclusive. They are discriminating people. And we have examples here in Europe. We don't need to go to Africa, Latin America, or Asia. With the situation of Syrian and Ukrainian refugees. There were double standards, different way of treating this based on race, origin, and also religion. And that is the issue that philanthropic organizations need to have in account. How we will address this polarized world, and how we will keep in our organization, philanthropic organizations, very strongly connected with our principles, our values. And the values for humanities, they are completely, it's terrible today. Let's go to see what's going on in Gaza, how it's normalized. That's normal in the name of security, in the name of fighting terrorism. We are losing values for humanity. And philanthropic organizations have a big, big role to play in that, not in terms of only providing or funding or providing assistance, but also helping to keep the principles that we need to be an inclusive world. You mentioned climate change. We know how much that is affecting many populations. And we know that the ethics cannot be separated from the values of humanity. Human rights needs to be associated with that. That is also another chapter that people want to change. We need to be aware that basically we have two ways to go. A way that is of inclusion with principles that we are taking care not only of our own financials or personal interests, but also in terms of humanity, in terms of the planet as that we will live in the future today. So I can see in all the continents, having been, as I mentioned in the beginning, more than 100 countries, that the panorama is not that good. And if you will not address the issues of values and ethic that is providing elements for supporting this, then I do not know for how long we will be here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rudelmar, and everybody for this first round of super interesting reflections. We don't have time for another complete second round of other reflections, so I'll use my joker question. And since we're talking of a new paradigm, we talked about biases, very complex problems, need for collaboration, need to do things better. One thing that didn't really come up to now, it's the role of data-driven decision-making. And I know, Nina, maybe for the younger generations that we've been interviewing and talking to, that you know, data is really something that they value a lot when they want to make their decisions. If I could get quick reactions from every one of you on the role of using data to make informed decisions, to try to tackle biases, to be more effective in collaborating, and so on. And maybe, Etienne, I start from you, and then we move closer to me. And I'll try to keep you at 2 minutes each, roughly.
I think I'll be even shorter. Very often we think decisions are very rational and based on data and track record and dashboards. My experience in philanthropy that it's a fine line between the heart and the head. And very often it's also about leaderships and people you trust and you value. So I don't dismiss the notion of data, but as a quick answer, I think we overstressing data is not my observation, even with young one. I think the notion of personal leadership, of how you may build trust. If that helped to build trust, maybe, but I have a sense that in my experience, data is of relevance and importance to prepare the decisions, but it's not always the main driver of when decision is made, but that's a personal statement.
Thanks.
And oh my God, I would completely agree with you, actually. and I think it's definitely has a huge importance in transparency. And I think we need more transparency, especially in the philanthropic sector, which is traditionally quite intransparent. But that transparency drives trust, right? And what we see though in philanthropy is this, I guess another trend of more, let's put it more trust-based philanthropy as well. So going away from these heavy mechanisms of data and reporting, not minimizing it because it's definitely important. We need to know the impact, but we're going towards a shift where people are trusting the communities and they want to build and have that trust. So for transparency, absolutely. For impact measurements, clearly it's still important, but we see it going a little bit more towards a different shift.
Rudelmar, if you want to go next.
About data.
Well, actually, most of the philanthropic organizations, especially humanitarian development and that are delivering services, that's fundamental. Baselines, and that is a requirement for any kind of funding that they are receiving. So that's important, transparency. There is also data manipulation for different interests. Sometimes these ethics issues, like let's take the issue of gender, or sexual reproductive health and rights, or protection of LGBTQI plus communities. This data sometimes is not available because ethically we don't want to address these issues. So that is the critical analysis that we need to do in terms of how to take this element into account.
I'm just sharing a few thoughts. I think I can see both when it comes to philanthropy. With some foundations we work with charitable foundations, big ones, small ones, but we also work with private individuals. And with some foundations there has been, and I think that's one of the trends that Nina mentioned, for like professionalism, so they want to get more complex in everything they do, more data, more monitoring, longer forms to fill out before they would give money, which I'm not sure this is always really leading in the right direction. But at the same time, I think when working with private individuals, I can see that very often the decision on where in the end they want to invest their money in is very much a personal thing, be it because they have a personal relation to a certain region, a country, a cause that is dear to their heart. But we see it very rare that people just say, like, put the money there where you feel it's needed the most, or it makes the most sense.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to say data sets are as good as what you make out of them, you know. You can collect, I mean, just to combine the comments so far, we use data sets depending on the purpose it serves. So I will just give one example. Manipur gets 0.04% of all CSR funding that is available in India. It's a mandatory requirement by the Indian government for companies of a certain size to invest part of their profit into CSR projects. But of all the money that's there, Manipur gets 0.04%. We use that to talk to donors and say, look, this is a state that is ignored, support us. But the decision-making ultimately comes to the personal relationship that you're able to establish with your donors, with your stakeholders and partners. And that part you cannot ignore. Data only sort of supports what we are trying to achieve in terms of convincing a donor that we can benefit from that funding. And once that funding comes through, we do what we can to bring a transparent a tracking process for the donor to see how projects are being implemented. There is nothing, in my opinion, better than a combination of data and personal faith to build that trust that builds a long-term relationship. Thank you.
Well, I believe that one of the things I want to share is that we should broaden the definition of people in need, especially in China. China is a country that, you know, developed really fast, and the people notion of people in need didn't grow as fast as the economy. For example, we help acquire in, you know, a poor area, and this is very controversial. People believe that they can survive there already, so we should just stop helping them because they're out of absolute poverty. But that is not enough. People deserve more than they thought they should. And this includes spiritual needs and, you know, like art and music, and we should help them to fulfill it. Like for children who are abandoned, we know that more than 98% of them experience a health issue, like they experience physical pain, but people don't know that they experience mental pain as well. Like they are disconnected to the society and they don't feel acceptance, they don't feel respect. And instead of just, you know, trying to solve their physical problem, their mental issue should be focused as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'll ask the if there are any questions already submitted, and if you want to ask a question if not done yet, there is the QR code here that you can use to submit questions.
Several questions or one at a time?
We have a lot of
questions. We'll do two. Okay, lots of questions with lots of parts. So I guess a first key question that came up in a lot of the responses was, how do philanthropic organizations determine the causes that they invest in? You've all touched on this a little bit in terms of thinking about the head and the heart, but maybe if we go further into like, what are the criteria that are being looked at? What's something that, I mean, what are the criteria that say, yes, we want to invest? And also what are common criteria mistakes that people think you want to hear, but you actually don't? Like data, we've had a mixed bag of who wants data and who wasn't. So for all of you, how does that kind of work? I'll leave that for now. That's several things.
Thank you. Who wants to go first?
I can go a little bit on that. What does, now you said philanthropic organizations, but maybe if I bring it to the philanthropist, so what does a foundation or a family or a philanthropist, what do they decide on? And I think here in my experience, I would say those individuals that would come to philanthropy advisory, maybe you will see if this is your experience too, but they would very often come because they want to figure out what, who, and where should they invest, right? And what we notice is that a philanthropist who feels very strong passion for a cause, they will become a much more effective philanthropist. So it really is key to find that one thing, okay, heart and mind, but it's really important to find that heart. And in order to do that, very often what we do together with families or individuals is trying to figure out what is it that they can have a strong affinity to. That could be an experience, that could be a skill set, that could be a little bit also on what sort of approach do they want to take, right? Say, for instance, if they want to campaign for a cause that they feel very strongly for, well, do they maybe have that network? Do they want to be open? Do they really want to go into that approach? But really, for me, I mean, it's really starts there. You need to figure out something that you can feel strong affinity to. That's where you start feeling the passion, and that's when you start researching the landscape analysis and the whole process and the strategy of building your philanthropic direction.
Does anyone want to add to that in terms of maybe what are common mistakes you see that organizations put as in their proposals that maybe to avoid in the future if people are submitting proposals to philanthropic institutions and people?
How we would go about it with Elea. So I mean, we have outlined four investment themes where we think we can make an impact for people living in absolute poverty. And then how do we proceed from there to identifying the ventures that we eventually invest in? Because we look for them ourselves, so we don't have like an application process like other organizations typically have. So we search for ventures that fit in our investment thesis. And then we, first of all, we look if we see they have an impact model. So they really have an impact for people in absolute poverty. And then of course the business model, is there a path to profitability in a certain time frame. But most importantly for us then really is also the entrepreneur and his or her team. Do we believe in this team? Do we want to work with them closely? Because we will be in the same boat. We will be together with them and really giving our all to making this venture succeed. So in the end, that's then one of our really also decisive factors before we invest.
Thank you.
And yeah, for an organization like ours, of course, we have, as you mentioned, we have very clear strategic priorities that we work, and we try, of course, to create the nexus between them, because they're everything interconnected today: climate change, gender justice, migration and displacement, or peace and human security. But one thing that you ask, the things that we do not see or you don't want to talk about in philanthropic, it's a little bit what is very much in the agenda today and we do not speak about. That is the decolonization aspect and the racism and anti-racism dimension that we do not see yet very clearly today. And that has a big impact on the outcomes of the our ethical decisions or our work as a philanthropic organizations. So I think that we need to have in mind.
Thank you for bringing that into the discussion. So a next question that came up, this was specifically to Elena, but also if others have input, please jump right in. How can philanthropy counter corruption? What safeguards do you look for or advise?
that's a tough question. I mean, we don't get involved in corruption with our ventures. As far as we can, foresee it from here, from where we are, and I think we have a fairly good understanding because we are so close to them that we do see their books. So if they would have like a very big, so to speak, budget or hidden bucket for corruption, I think this would be visible to us. But for us, of course, that's absolutely a no-go. But it's also clear that in the markets where we are active with Elea, corruption is a topic.
Thank you so much. So then I think maybe I'll bring in this question. Maybe we'll have a final one. But we talked about kind of reconciling sustainability and short-term investment. So what are some key strategies for organizations to think about in terms of sustainability, of keeping an organization running, but also that it's being effective? And so what would you advise nonprofits or civil society organizations to do today to align with philanthropic trends and priorities?
I think one of the things that we try to do to maintain sustainability is that we try to encourage more young people to get involved. We try to get them involved in, you know, philanthropy activity in their early stage of life so that they know what it's like to get involved in charity, and they know the joy of it, so that they're more likely to be part of it in the future. And you know, encourage more and more young people to keep on our journey. And another way to keep the sustainability is to collaborate with, you know, companies, because like most of our funds have to come from people who have money, and that's basically entrepreneurs and companies, and have connection and engagement with this company is essential for this sustainability of any charity foundations. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So just to build on the people element, I think if you want to build a sustainable organization, and I'm talking here from an implementation point of view, you need to build the capacity of your team. Select, you know, the right people, enable them, build their capacity, and that is the only way they can run an independent organization that is aligned to the mission, the purpose of the organization. From a donor sort of philanthropist side, sustainability comes obviously, you know, in many forms. How do you sustain this financial responsibility that you have taken up by starting a philanthropic movement? You know, if you're putting in $300 million today, How are you going to sustain that tomorrow, day after? And Switzerland, for me, is the best country to learn this. I think in Basel, I may be wrong, but please check it up. For every 200 or 300 citizens of Basel, there is a philanthropic organization, family trust, corporate trust, you name it. And this is why, for me, being in Basel and seeing how others operate and how they manage to sustain philanthropic organizations for generations, there's a lot to learn there. And it's all about building the right team, the right people around you.
Thank you so much. So I think we're out of time for... Also, did someone else want to add?
Oh,
go, please.
I was just going to say something very quick. I mean, working with donors and from the philanthropist side, and work with donors and philanthropists and make sure that they give this multi-year funding. That is definitely also something that we see. We completely discourage to make those shorter terms. Funding cycles, but long term. So that is definitely one thing. And then the second thing, I'll just put it out there, because I was at a dinner last week, actually, and it was hosted by a very successful businessman. And he was saying that in business, to be successful, he's so used to be taking risks. And that is the one thing that keeps the success and his business going. And he was saying, but in philanthropy, having that courage to take risk. But I would actually say that that is also something that we very often encourage in philanthropy advisory. Be the ones that take the risk. And when you do have that trust with your organizations that you're working, give them that benefit of making and taking those risks for long-term success and sustainability.
Great point to end on.
Thank you so much for this super interesting and exciting panel. I feel for sure that I learned so much from each and every one of you. So please join me in a quick round of applause for our panelists.